Good morning, August 19th, 2012. There is a first time for everything, right, in this world. And so the clarifications I'm bringing in, it's a first time thing. That's why we may look for corroboration and not find it and say, well, then is it true? I mean, someone else must have said this before, right? But again, if somebody else had said it before, that would be a first time, right? And maybe somebody did try, and yet they backed off because there was no corroboration in the past. People would ask them, well, where's your sources? Who else has said this in the past? And if they can't find anyone, they might say, oh my gosh, I better just stick to what has been said in the past, and I can cite all these, you know, others that are saying the same thing. In this case, there isn't anyone that is saying in this particular style. I can't find anyone. I search, hoping to find someone else so I can say, yeah, this is someone else is also saying this. Maybe it would make it a lot easier, right? Because there's a tendency here to not believe anything unless it's been said before. But again, that's an infinite regress, isn't it? Because then you go back to who said it before and say, well, when they said that, was there someone before them? And go back further. When they said it, it was home before them. And you have to get back to a point where there had to be a first time. There had to be a pioneer moment. And so that's what this is. This is a pioneering effort to say these things here in this world, which is much more direct and much more time-saving than what's been said before. That's the whole purpose. The purpose is to bring in that which is saves time, saves delay, by being more direct and condensed. Even A Course in Miracles doesn't say this directly. It lays the framework for saying this, but it doesn't really say it exactly the way it's being said here at all. So I cannot cite A Course in Miracles and say, oh yeah, I'm just saying what A Course in Miracles said. No, I'm saying it in a more condensed fashion by far. So we're pioneers, which is a great thing to someone has to do it. At some point, someone has to say, well, so what if no one else has said this yet? There's a first time. You know, we need to save more time. And the reason why it's being done now is because we are under the gun, and there's more urgency, there's more intensity than ever, because we're under the gun of this unbelievable scenario that is creeping up on us like a cat creeping up on a bird and is ready to pounce on us when we're not hardly aware of it at all. Most people are acting like everything's fine. When you see a little bird and the bird is looking for seeds on when a cat is creeping up, the bird is oblivious and the bird's chirping and happy, and you think, oh, there's nothing wrong. But if there's a third party looking at this whole thing saying, whoa, wait a minute, that bird is about ready to be turned into a feather pie, you know. So just because the world seems oblivious and everyone seems to be materialistically content doesn't mean that everything is fine at all. There are third parties who are aware of the bigger picture, who are saying, oh my gosh, the cat is about ready to pounce. My gosh, I had a dream last night of a mountain lion. Wow. Walking among the streets, the city, this huge mountain lion. I remember I got down and I was in the city and going through all the streets and everything. I said, oh my gosh, I hope I don't meet up with that mountain lion because I'm roaming free. You know, there is this destructivity that is ready to pounce on this world, and all is not well. So we are under the gun big time. This brings about a greater effort and focus, okay, and that brings about a greater clarity. When I look at the history of spiritual teaching on this planet, I see a lack of focus, I see a lack of urgency, I see a lack of clarity, I see a fuzziness. Very fuzzy. And quite frankly, it's acceptable because we have to get it now. I mean, we can't just say, well, we're going to just pass this down and gradually develop it. No, we're out of time. We're out of time. We run out of time in this stage, this staging area. And if we don't want to go on to another staging area, then we have to get it now. So it requires a very adamant teaching. And I don't know if I'm going to delineate certain teachers, you know, who have messed things up or not. I said I'd think, consider it. I don't know. Maybe it's better just to sweep right past them. Don't want to give them the publicity anyway. So we're up against it all. But fortunate are the ones who realize this, you know? Fortunate are the ones that are suffering right now, that are feeling, you know, those are the fortunate ones. Because there's, excuse me, there's a sense of urgency, And that's why you're listening to these videos, is you're getting the sense of urgency. Like, we got to get it now, and we can get it now. We can get it, except there is this slow pace, this of the past. The past is still with us, and it's dragging us down. And I'd like to shed it entirely. You know, just shed it entirely. It has to be shed. The teachings of the past are not appropriate for this right now, because we have, you know, we're talking about months kind of thing. The whole ball game is shrinking down. It's like we're in the bottom of the ninth inning or the last quarter, you know, and the time on the clock is ticking down, or we got two more outs, you know. We've got to put on this intense rally right now while we're going to be propagandized by loss and destruction. We don't want to be propagandized by that. We want to say, no, thank you, not necessary. And the entire thing has been laid out clearly for me. It's frustrating because it's the doggone way that we work, is that we say, well, how can I link this with the past? You cannot really do it. And so somehow we have to make a clean break with the past, you know? Clean break with the past. We have to get escape velocity. We don't have escape velocity. It's like the plane is going down the runway, and it's not quite going fast enough to take off. And so if we keep going down the runway, it's the most frustrating thing imaginable, isn't it? The passengers are in the plane, and the plane's bumping along the runway. And say, come on, come on, come on, you know, take off, take off, take off, we gotta take off. And if we just went a little faster, you know, we'd take off. Except the weight, we got some kind of parachute on the back of the plane, and that parachute is the past. The past is like a parachute dragging us, slowing us down. Honestly, I would let go of all teachers in the past, all teachings of the past. For me, I would let go of all of them. Don't need them. Don't need any of them. Don't need any teaching, any, because right now, right here, the focus is more intense and more spot on. And wow. And we think, oh no, we've got to bring all this with us. Don't know. We don't need to. I know it may seem over the top to say these things, but it's not, from my perspective, really. I don't need to bring any books with me, so to speak, in the airplane. I don't need to bring any teacher with me in the airplane. Don't need anything, because it's all very, very clear. Okay. Either God can change reality, or God cannot change reality. And all we have to do is simply look at that and then see the two belief systems that must arise from that and realize those are the only two belief systems that can possibly arise, right? Because we know it can't be both. So literally, we simply choose either one belief system or the other. crystal clear, completely obvious. And we can see, if we choose the one that God can change reality, then we can easily see that belief system, okay, and how it must function, and all everything must take place. And we say, ah, we've been operating within that belief system, no doubt about it. And they see the other belief system, and we can easily see how that might unfold, okay, has a different premise entirely, right? So we have two premises, and we simply must choose one or the other. It's crystal clear. And that's all you need to know as far as to take off. That's all you need to know. And we keep thinking we need to know something else. We don't. From my standpoint, just seeing that, the two belief systems, that based on what we choose to believe, either God can change reality or God cannot. Either reality can, that's it. Don't need anything more than that as far as to take off. And then it's easy to put everything in the right perspective or in the right context from that standpoint. Easy. No trouble whatsoever. We literally don't need any other teaching. Don't need it. And yet we're busy trying to, invite on the plane everything. Come on in. And it muddles it all up. Try to integrate all that. Well, how do I fit this in this teaching and this teacher? How do I do that? And that weighs us down. The plane gets so weighted, then we can't take off. And we need to take off. We need it to be streamlined. We need the plane to be very streamlined and unencumbered. And everything you don't need, jetson it off the plane. Gotta keep jetsoning, so the plane will take off. And that's what I'm here for, is just to urge us all to jetson all the stuff. It's not needed. It's not needed. It's not needed at all. All we need is to realize it has to be either God can change reality or God cannot change reality. One of the two. Or if you're an atheist, you can say either reality can be changed or reality cannot be changed. Same thing. So don't try to get tricky and say, well, I don't believe in God, so there must be something else. No, either reality can be changed or it can't be changed, But ultimately, the fact is that we are not prime creator. So there is a source. You can call it source, prime creator, whatever you want. But can that source change reality? Either yes or no. There isn't any other option. Either reality can be changed or it can't be changed. There isn't anything else. And again, if you believe it can be changed, that's a belief system. A belief system will arise from that. If you believe it cannot be changed, a belief system will arise from that. Very simple. And so you don't even have to decide decisively at this point which one. What you have to do is you have to decisively realize that it has to be one or the other. And that a choice, we do have the power of choice to choose one or the other. That is all that's needed. Really, it has to be one or the other. Can't be both. Cannot be both. Cannot integrate the two. No way. So everything involved with integrating the two, you can jetson. Throw it out the plane. All right. Throw it out the plane. And when you throw all that out the plane, then it becomes very clear. Say, well, wait, and you can focus in on this, and then literally you can quickly discern, You can see what we've been trying to do. And you can see we've been trying to get reality to be changed. It's not difficult. What is difficult is when you're trying to integrate the two, you got no chance. No chance. The whole thing gets weighted down. So you don't have escape velocity. That plane just keeps going down the runway and never takes off. Cannot take off. Cannot. It's weighted down with endless considerations in seeking for all sorts of teaching. Like, how can I, you know, do this? Oh my gosh. But when you see, wow, there simply has to be two belief systems, and one has to be right and the other has to be wrong. That's it. You don't need to go any further than that. One has to be right and the other has to be wrong, has to be mistaken. And they both can't be right. It's impossible. And they both can't be mistaken either. Okay? That's also impossible. And when you see it this way, you have what's called escape velocity. Okay, escape velocity. It means you're above it. You're above a certain level where all this destructivity, everything is going to be play out. You're not on that level anymore, because that doesn't concern you. The only thing that concerns you at this point is which is true, which is mistaken. That's it. There isn't anything else that's concerning you. And you don't need the outplay of all this stuff in existence to consider which is right and which is wrong. You don't need it. Like, coming into this world, I've never felt like I needed this world at all. I don't need it. It's not necessary. It's not necessary to dwell here at all. The external stuff isn't needed, because the question is which of these positions, beliefs, is true and which is false. And that is something that is worked through with reason. Circumstances really play no part in it. You can literally be in a cave and nothing happening, it doesn't matter. Or you can be in a place of you know, no loss. But of course we'd reject that. But so, because we haven't quite decided which is true and which is false, but we can arise and the plane can take off, and while we're on that plane flight, we can be up in the air circling, so to speak, as we are considering which is true and which is false. One of them has to be true, one of them has to be false. Can't both be true and can't both be false. Therefore, we can be in a plane circling, not landing anywhere necessarily, but we don't need to be in the midst of all this turmoil. Whatever happens in this world, it's irrelevant. It's irrelevant to us at this point. If we can say, well, we're not sure which is true and which is false, then we don't have to go with either one at this point, do we? We don't have to go to the lost free world of paradise. We don't have to remain immersed in this lost-based scenario of existence. We can kind of be in an intermediate limbo-like situation temporarily as we consider, you know, which is true and which is false. Now, I already know which is true and which is false. However, in order to get escape velocity, I don't believe that is necessary. It's enough to be determined, to realize that there, a determination needs to be made. And you don't want to be bothered by anything extraneous to that. That determination is all important. All important. Nothing else is important. And you say, well, until I can make this determination, I don't really need to be bothered by extraneous drama. The dramas are not important at all. Really not important. What we're trying to do is get that plane off the ground, because on the ground here is very bad situations. On the ground here is those who believe that reality can be changed. That is that's their game. This is their scenario. Okay? Let them have their scenario. But you, at least you have doubt about that. They say, now wait a minute. I'm not so sure that reality can be changed. This hasn't been established at all. And certainly, it can't be both. It can't be both changed and not changed. That's not possible. And so, at least if you have some doubts, you know, wait a minute, whoa. I don't want to go whole hog in with the scenario of the reality can be changed, because I'll tell you, existence is that. It is all in to change, that reality can be changed. It's all in. It disguises this by claiming it's an integration, it's a process of integration. That is a lie. And you should know it's not possible to integrate these two. You have to have a little faith, you know, in your intuition, seeing this, in your inner seeing of this. You know this is so. The existence disguises what it's about so that we continue on with it. That is what is happening, really. This, and it pretends like it's integrating. It says, oh, no, you know, we're not, we don't believe that way. We kind of believe both ways. That is what must be rejected entirely. You cannot believe both ways. Not possible. These belief systems are mutually exclusive. The belief system that reality can be changed is mutually exclusive from the belief system that reality cannot be changed. Totally mutually exclusive. Guarantee you that. One entirely rejects the other. Has to, right? Just seeing this is all that is needed. Nothing more at this point. Now, of course, it is possible to completely clarify the whole situation. I've done it. I know it's possible. It simply requires this basic understanding. You can't have both. Both can't be true. So which is false? And then you go in and you start investigating. And through your own investigation and clarification, you can easily find out which is false. You can do it. Now, so, but at this point, most people in this world are not sure. So I cannot get anywhere with telling you, well, reality cannot be changed. I'm certain of it, because you're not certain of it. Most are not certain of this because they haven't been able to spend the time to clearly see it. But you can get to the point where you're positive that both can't be true. You can get that point, and that's all that's needed right now. Okay, at this particular juncture, all that is needed is that you realize that both can't be true, not possible, and therefore your only responsibility must be to discern which is true and which is false. And if you just be honest and say, both can't be possible, okay, I know that is true, and then ask yourself, well, which is true, which is false? And if you say, well, I don't know, then you say, oh my gosh, I've got some work to do. And then you ask, well, what kind of work? Well, I just have to discern which is true and which is false. And you say, okay, well, what's the best situation I can be in to help me discern that? You know, and then you're being honest, and then you're asking the right questions, and you have the right focus. And that'll get you out of this world, as it'll get escape velocity. It'll put you in a situation where you can spend your time discerning this, okay? What you know is simply the right use of time. You simply are oriented towards the right use of time. That is all. That's it. It is so simple. And you think it can't be that simple. It is. It is nothing more than that. And you think, well, how come this hasn't been laid out before? It's because in the past, we were going down the runway kind of slow, and we're looking out the windows, and we're saying, wow, this is kind of interesting. Wow, I don't really want to take off, because look over there, and look over there, and this world's kind of interesting. I wonder what the future will bring. And you got your foot on the brake. You're going down the runway, but you got the foot on the brake because you really didn't want to take off yet, because you thought you wanted to see what was going to happen. Well, and we wanted to see the world, you know. Well, the fact is that the internet has enabled us, the right use of it has enabled us to see what's going on around the world. to see all of the world. We can see Antarctica, the North Pole, the Himalayas, wherever. I'm able to do that, and I've done it. I made right use of the internet, and I'm still doing that. I can see a true yogi in a cave in the Himalayas going through their spiritual practices, you know. I say, I don't need to go to the Himalayas to see that. Someone took a video of it. Thank you. Thank you to all the people who have taken videos. When video cameras first came out, I got one right away, and I've been taking videos ever since and trying to share. And other people have been doing that. That is right use, is people taking videos, sharing them, so that everyone around the world can get that. And it's, putting it in Creative Commons is better. But even so, if they don't, that's fine too. And so you can see this yogi doing their ascetic practices, like standing, you know, for 7 years. I watched a video of the yogi just standing for 7 years, never sitting down. Yogi rolling around on the road for, like, you know, thousands of miles the whole way, just rolling, doing all these ascetic practices. You can see this. You can see what has been going on throughout the world, throughout the history. You can see, you see so much, and you realize, wow, yeah, it really is what I thought it really is. It is what it is. It's not something else. You can see all these South Sea islands, you know, Micronesia, and all these islands, and you can see the grass huts that people used to live in. I go into university libraries, digitized libraries, and look at the pictures, the historical pictures of the past, and you see, wow, okay, I don't have to go there, you know. We're in an incredibly advantageous position right now, the best ever, which enables us to take our foot off the brake. And not a minute too soon, because, you know, like the plane is going down the runway, right? It's been going down a long time. We've been driving this plane down the runway, but the fact is, there's a cliff, and the runway is going to end very soon. And so we better get escape velocity, or that plane is going to plunge down into the abyss. So it's not a moment too soon that we're getting this. And you know, I spend most of my time on YouTube looking at videos, or searching through images and photo collections and image collections. That's how I spend my time, or taping here, or, you know, working to pay bills. That's it. I'm not wasting time going anywhere, really, because we need to go faster than that. You know, I can go all over the world in one evening and go so many places and look at so many things, see the northern lights. I don't have to wait, you know, see videos that have been taken of all this stuff that's happening. I see the glaciers melting. One night I can encompass a massive amount of information about the world. And I've been doing that nonstop ever since the internet came out. And just seeing, wow, this is the world. You know, this is what this place looks like. This is what this place looks like. And you realize, wow, is that all there is? Really? That's it. You know, that is the world. Wow. I don't need to spend all my time. I was very advantageous position, because my dad was an explorer, and he traveled all over the world. He said he'd been to almost every place, you know, every continent, every area of the world, just about. That was his goal, to go everywhere in the world. And so I asked him, I said, hey, you know, what did you find? He says, you know what? You know, there is no paradise in this world. Wherever you go, it's the same. And I said, yeah, that's what I believe. That's what I know. And so from that point on, I realized I don't have to travel anywhere. He did it for me. You know, this is a collective effort here in this world, okay? Escape velocity is a collective effort. Okay, and we're trying to get everyone on the plane and the plane to take off, and I'm just some, you know, maybe I'm like a cabin steward or something, I don't know. So you learn from other people's efforts. You learn from it. I didn't say to my dad, I didn't say, well, you just didn't look good enough, so I'm going to go out and look too. No, because he was a fabulous explorer. And he went to fabulous places. He wanted to find the best places in the world. And he'd go to all these places, you know. He'd be on top of some sacred mountain when the sun rose, everyone chanting and everything, and, you know, he'd say, you know, is that it? Did he get it? So he came back and reported to me. He made his report before he passed away. He made his report and he said, no, you're not going to find it here. No way. Doesn't matter where you go. You know, when he was young, he was traveling across the equator in Africa, all the way across from one coast to the other coast. And he came out across in the middle of the night. He was at dusk, when it was getting dark. He came out through the jungle, and he suddenly came across the Congo, and the full moon was shimmering on the Congo and everything. And he was just like completely stunned, you know. And he had some kind of, you know, peak moment at that time. So he kept chasing after peak moments around the world, wherever it was. And he had all these peak moments. And then he came back and reported to me, and he said, no, that's not it. Don't waste your time. Don't waste your time. That was the great gift he gave to me and through me to the world. You know? He was an intrepid traveler and explorer, and he came back to me and said, don't waste your time. So I didn't. I didn't waste my time. I took that to heart. And, you know, what we need to do in this world is to take to heart the reports we get back from reliable sources that are giving us, saying, hey, don't waste your time here. Don't waste your time there. And so I'm also saying this. Okay, I'm reporting back to you, saying, don't waste your time here. Don't waste your time there. Okay, don't waste your time with all these spiritual teachings. Don't waste your time with all these spiritual teachers in the past. Don't waste your time there. Okay. You're not going to get it there. You're going to get it by the simplest of honesty. Honesty is the highest teaching. Being honest with yourself and just saying, asking the question, can reality be both changed? And is it possible to change reality, or is it impossible to change reality? And realizing you can't have it both ways. You can't have it that it's impossible to change it, and you can't have it that it's possible to change it. You can't have it. One of those positions has to be false. And when you recognize this, you realize that you have the honesty and clarity within you to be free, to realize the truth, whatever it is. You have it within you. Everybody does. And you don't need to waste any time seeking it somewhere else. You already got it. You have it. I don't need to find some guru or seek somewhere. I know I already have it within me. Everybody has it within them. Now, a teacher simply makes this, helps us realize this, that we have it within us, the honesty to just look at the situation, because it simply is so simple. So everybody that takes off on that plane is simply those who have practiced honesty and have taken it to heart, the reports that they've gotten back from others. They've taken it to heart and not arrogantly rejected it, you know, and said, hey, you know, yeah, let me take this to heart. So what I'm sharing here, maybe I'll share in some ways more specifically. I don't know. Or maybe you can just take it to heart. Those who would take it to heart, they don't even need specifics. Like, I didn't need my dad to give me chapter and verse, you know. Maybe he gave me a little bit. Yeah, he was in some, you know, pool and in some hot springs in northern Japan with some Zen master, you know, and all the stuff he did, all the stuff he went to, all these gurus and all these masters in all these incredibly exotic places and ashrams all over the world. And had all these moments, high moments with, you know, of epiphanies and peak moments, etc. And he came back and reported to me saying, don't waste your time. Don't waste your time. So that's an incredible gift to the world that he did. And I'm expanding upon that because I have done my own search, an incredible search, through all the spiritual teachings in the history of this planet. And I'm saying, dump them all in the ocean. Leave them all behind. They're not worth staying here in this world for. Guaranteed, they're not worth dying for. Guaranteed. There is no teaching that's ever been given out on this planet that is worth dying for. That you should feel like you are deprived by leaving it behind. None. Truth is within you. The clarity is within you. The honesty is within you. The discernment is incredibly simple. You don't need this big song and dance. You don't need it at all. You simply say either God can change reality or God can't change reality. It's one or the other. And then when you start looking at it, you will automatically, you'll start remembering that you're attempting to get, one belief system is trying to get God to change reality. And the other belief system is saying, no, I know God, you can't change reality. So let us be truly reconciled entirely to that fact. That is it. It's so simple. So, my dad's gift was to say, stop searching in the world. You're not going to find it in the world. Okay? Forget it. You're not going to find what you really want in the world. You will not. And then my gift is stop searching in any spiritual teachings or any spiritual teachers or anything like that. You're not going to find what you really want there either. You're going to find it in your own clarity, in your own capacity within that you have to be honest and to say, wait a minute, both of these can't be true. They cannot both be true. That is all you need. Truth is true, and only truth is true, and lies can never be true. That is all you need to know. That is the entirety of it as your foundation. And then it's very simple to from that foundation to make clear discernment. It's not difficult. What gets you into difficulty is thinking there needs to be some integration, which is a delusion, right? So all you're doing is just saying, no, those two belief systems cannot be integrated, and I don't need to try to accomplish the impossible. Cannot never be integrated, so I'm just, all my attempts to integrate these two belief systems have been a waste of time. That's all. I've been grounded. I couldn't take off. Plane could not take off. As long as I'm trying to integrate the two, I'm bogged down. You know, the wheels are going in mud. You know, the plane can't take off because it's going through mud. Get on the tarmac. You know, get on the hard surface that is. And the plane suddenly can take off. Picks up speed. When you see this, it picks up speed, escape velocity. So take this to heart. I'm sharing with you from spending a lifetime of investigating spiritual teachings and spiritual teachers. That's all I've done. I've just done a total enormous job through everything. I've plowed through it all the fields. Leave it all behind. You don't need any of it. None of it. The voice of reason is within you. You know, I could be sent to a desert island, okay, but there's nothing. I would not panic. I would not freak out and say, there's no teacher here. There's no teaching. Not needed. It is not needed. You have it. You carry everything you need with you wherever you go. Wherever you go, you can always say, wait a minute. Which is true? Can God change reality or can God not change reality? That one question, which is true? Ask yourself that question. And then say, can they both be true? Ask yourself that. And if you can say, well, now wait a minute, no. Either reality can be changed or it can't be changed, right? Either reality can be changed or it can't be changed. And then ask yourself, well, how come I'm not sure which is true? Okay, and say, wow, okay, now what? Why am I not very clear of which is true? Now, if you believe, oh, definitely it can be changed, then you're not even asking this question at all, and you are immersed in the what existence is all about, which is trying to change reality, trying to get God to change reality. But if you are honest, you'd say, well, do I know which is true? Am I sure which is true? How can I be sure which is true? You know, then you pull back from either one. You kind of pull back and say, wait a minute. Let me start considering this. I gotta get clear about this. And you have the capacity within you to get clear about it. Because you say, well, it's not possible they both be true. That assertion right there is enough to dispel the clouds. I mean, it's like the light of truth is within you, and it just dispels falsity. Automatically, it dispels it as you keep shining that light. And you don't try and, you know, go whole hog into either one. Just keep shining that light and say, which is true, which is true, which is true. They can't both be true. Which is true, which is true. They can't both be true. I need to know which is true, which is true. You know, and you keep working on it, keep working on it, keep working on it. You will unravel, you will untangle, and you will see, ah, my gosh, I now know, you know, which is true. Or you can say, I have the weight of evidence is entirely over here, and it's not over here at all. Okay. Total certainty from a conceptual level is not possible, because only through actually experience does the total knowing come. But you can be positive beyond any reasonable doubt of which is true. You can. Absolutely. I am positive beyond any reasonable doubt that reality cannot be changed. God cannot change reality. It's not possible. Okay. The only step past that is then an actual knowing, actual experiential knowing of it. That is the next step. But we don't have to take that step in order to get escape velocity, okay, from this scenario of this world that is unfolding, which is an attempt to generate a massive amount of loss and suffering, death, misery, sickness, all of that, destruction, to try and coerce the prime creator into changing reality, which is obviously based on the belief that reality can be changed, right? Because if you didn't know, if you said, wait a minute, I'm not so sure that reality can be changed, you would pull back from the scenario. You say, no. Now, this is very premature. I don't want to be involved in this scenario because I'm not at all sure that reality can be changed. So why should I be going all in to try to generate this power that threatens Prime Creator and forces Prime Creator to change reality? Because that's what existence is. We're trying to generate a power that will frighten Prime Creator into changing reality. And this power we're trying to manufacture, is the power of destruction, power of loss. We're trying to show, by all the loss that we're dreaming up in existence, where spirit is imagining all this, but it seems very real to us, because it's like a dream. We're trying to show this to Prime Creator and say, look at the power that we have. We have this power to wipe out everything, and we're going to use it on you. We got this weapon we're going to use on you if you don't change reality for us, because we want to be Prime Creator. That is the origin of all of this. And I'm clear about all this because I realize that truth and lies can't both be true, that either reality can be changed or it can't be changed. It can't be both. For that simple realization, you're able to track down the whole root of existence and see what it is we're trying to do with existence. At that point, then, you know, you don't need any existence at all, even all the subtle levels you don't need. You can be, literally, you can get free of all of it. But at this point, we don't need to go that far. We only need to go to, wait a minute, whoa, whoa, whoa. I am not willing to put myself through this orgy of destructivity and loss because I'm not at all sure that I need to accrue that evidence. Because I'm not at all yet certain. I'm not at all certain of which of these is true. So why should I be throwing my weight behind one or the other at this point, right? Because if we stay in this world, we are literally throwing our weight behind the belief that reality can be changed. We are literally doing that. Okay? And if we say, wait a minute, I'm not at all sure which of these is true, and I know both of them can't be, so I really would rather spend my time seeing which is true before I throw my weight behind either one of them. That gives you wings. It gives you wings. You can then have escape velocity from this. And don't worry about the details, etc. You must be passed by. If you have this attitude, the Passover principle works, okay? There is this principle. You will literally, the world will pass you by and say, ah, well, this one doesn't want to participate, so later, you know. It's like that. And of course, the destructivity that is coming is not just personal, the physical body, the etheric, the you know, involving people. It's involving much more than people. It's involving many levels, many kingdoms, you know. It's involving this planet. It's involving the solar system. It's involving a lot. So the Passover here is simply not like, you know, oh, you're going to be on a nice little island somewhere and the rest of the world is going to go, you know, go through their turmoil. And then everything will be fine. No, the Passover at this point in time is greater than that. Literally, the solar system will pass you by. The universe will pass you by, as it were. Maybe let's not go so far to say the universe, okay? That's not, because where we're at right now, that is beyond where we are at. I can probably have the universe pass me by at this point, but where this teaching is at here, what we're looking at is the solar system, so to speak, passing us by, this area of the cosmos passing over, which means a translation into another area of the cosmos, as it were. Okay. We'll keep us in the context of the universe, okay. For now. Ultimately, when you discern that reality can't be changed, then you don't need the universe at all. The whole universe will pass you over. And what's left? Unconditional love, showing, you know, absolute beauty beyond what we can even talk about at this point, really. That will happen. But we don't need to be concerned with that. What we need to be concerned about is going through a Passover process. And we don't need to do it, boom, necessarily all at once. Maybe it's possible to get into a place where we feel a little safer, where physically we won't be bothered, and then emotionally we won't be bothered, mentally we won't be bothered, and go through kind of a translation process. I'm not exactly sure if it's going to be all at once or gradual. We need to ride this wave, ride this plane, the Passover plane, ride that plane. Because you're simply saying, I'm going to sit this one out. I'm going to sit this one out because I'm not at all convinced either way at this point. And that is great. That is all you need. And just say, put your authority that you have the authority to say, hey, I'm not convinced either way, so I want to be in a situation where I can focus on seeing which is true and which is false. That's all. And just insist upon it. Insist upon it. You got the power. No one has the power to turn you away from this. No, they don't. They absolutely don't. And if you say, wait a minute, I'm not sure which way, which is true and which is false, but I know one of them has to be false. And since I don't know which is false, I'm not all in either way. Not all in either way. Okay. So you don't have to be translated into the paradise realm, the lost free realm, which I know it's there. But you don't have to do that at this point. What you can look for is a situation of opportunity, of tranquility, of opportunity to spend a quiet life, as it were. Quiet situation. Peaceful, uneventful situation where you're not suffering all sorts of loss. And you may not be aware of unconditional love at the moment, but you are in a situation where you are able to spend your time recognizing which one is the lie and which one is the truth. Either reality can be changed or it can't be changed. Which one is true? And just focus on that. And I'm telling you, it's a fabulous lifestyle. Fabulous. Because you literally recollect and you gradually realize what it is you did, and you trace it back to the very root. And every step is like more and more hope. You say, I am almost able to see which is true and which is false, and I know when as soon as I see that, I am going to be free, I'm going to be happy, I am going to have what I really want. What I really want is to know which is true. What I really want to get away from is trying to integrate these two and being confused and not even being able to discern. That's what I want to get away from. And every step you take, you get away from that more and more and more. But in order to really, from what I've seen of the future, in order to do that, there is a Passover principle. Well, and you need to be aware of that Passover principle. I really believe that. We'll see how it plays out. We'll see how it plays out, because I believe it's moving time now. When I say moving time, I mean the Passover principle. You need to start riding that wave. You need to catch that wave. The plane has to start lifting off. The Passover plane needs to start lifting off. This needs to start happening because the winds of destructivity are getting ready to blow. You know, that pressure system is ready to move in. You know how it is when you're in a beautiful day and it's so calm and peaceful and quiet. And usually it's most still just before a storm in this world. And then suddenly the wind, the breeze starts coming through. So where'd that come from? And it builds and builds and builds. And before you know it, you know, everything's shaken. All the trees are shaken. Debris is being blown all over the place. As what happens? Pressure systems shifting and moving and changing like that. And so you may be sitting there, and the world may be very content, you know. But this pressure system that's coming in is like a cosmic pressure system. You know, there's space weather too. There's cosmic weather. There's cosmic pressure systems. The whole universe is just a pressure system. All gradations of pressure, really. And these pressure systems are always ceaselessly moving and changing, etc., you know. And so we're coming into a pressure system now, a cosmic pressure system, that is going to shake everything up here intensely and bring about unbelievable loss. Loss on a scale that we have not yet experienced on this planet. Really. These are what's called the end times, the end of the cycle, and a complete shakeup. A complete shakeup. And no matter how you slice that pie, I know there are plenty who say, well, in order to make a new beginning, we need to go through all this loss of the old has to be wiped out, of course. But in the wiping out of all of that, you are literally accruing massive evidence for loss, for this power of loss, the power of loss, power to wipe out whatever is supposedly in this dream, whatever is being wiped out. And that simply builds the belief system that you have the power, or you will soon have the power, to threaten reality and therefore force the prime creator to change reality. So this whole talk about, in order to get into the new age, we need to destroy the old age. It has to pass away entirely. That is literally building this belief system that reality can be changed. And again, if you are honest, you say, I don't know if that is true or not. You don't want to add any more loss at all, because that is skewing your efforts to determine which is true and which is false. Because it's like adding all this evidence to one side, making it extremely one-sided. And you say, wait a minute, why do I want to add all of this evidence, and I don't even know if this belief system is really true? It could be completely false. So it's a super reckless thing to do. Very irresponsible thing to do. I'll tell you that. If you want to be responsible, then you have to take responsible steps. And allowing yourself to bear witness to all this loss that's coming is tremendously irresponsible, unless you are positive that reality can be changed. Unless you're positive. And yet, I tell you for sure, nobody is positive, because ultimately, it cannot be changed. So how can anyone be totally positive? They cannot. That's why you take these false gurus who are pushing this agenda, this belief system, and they pretend like they're totally positive. Okay. Like they are God. They know everything, and they're 100% sure. You know, they are not. I guarantee you this is true, because I've examined them. I've observed them. I've carefully observed them. They are not 100% positive by any means, and they cover it up. They're very clever at hiding this. They're not 100% positive, because reality cannot be changed. But from where most of us are at, all we need is a reasonable doubt. Okay? With a reasonable doubt, you can then say, wait a minute, piling all this evidence up is irresponsible. Super irresponsible. Super irresponsible. Because I'm not at all sure that reality can be changed. So this is a dishonest, irresponsible, dishonest thing to put myself through all this loss. Very irresponsible. Because it's putting the cart in front of the horse. What you can say, honestly, is say, well, if I determine that reality can be changed, then I'll put myself through all this to build up this power to threaten, force God into changing it. But until I'm certain, positive, 100% positive, this is very wrong, very irresponsible, very crazy thing to do. And so you say, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. And what stands in your way is these gurus that came into the world who pretended to be all-knowing and positive, telling you, yeah, this it is possible to change reality. That they're positive. And so you're justified in putting yourself through all of this. You know, not true. They were not positive. They're bluffing. They're bluffing. What they're saying, what they really said is, if you put yourself through all this sacrifice, that will then activate this power that will force God to change reality. So that what they're saying is that they project it into the future, saying they're positive that in the future they will have the power. But even that they're not positive about. They're assuming it. They're presuming it. That it's a fait accompli, that if we just put ourselves through this loss scenario that's coming up, that will put us over the top. And so they basically come into the world and say, it's a fait accompli, you're going to succeed at this, you just have to stick with it, and we guarantee it. But they themselves are not certain about it. And that uncertainty unfolds in their life here in this world, where the wheels come off, you know. And you look at their lives and you say, whoa, wait a minute, whoa, 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 whoa. Look at their lives. And look at the boasting, the bragging, like, yeah, I'm going to be the prime creator real soon. You know, so might as well worship me now, get a head start. That's what they're saying. They're coming to the world and say, you know, I'm going to be prime creator very soon. So get in early, folks. And if you get in early and worship me, and then you're going to be ahead of everybody else, because I'm going to put you up high up in the hierarchy, my hierarchy, you know. And you say, well, are you prime creator right now? You know, say, well, I'm going to be very soon. So he might as, you know, why even quibble about it? If it's a fait accompli, why even ask that question? I said, well, maybe it's not a fait accompli, you know. And I'm not so sure it is. And that, you see, then you look at those people's lives, those gurus' lives, and it's a mess, you know. Say, prime, what are you, you're not prime creator, what are you talking about? And it's not a fait accompli, so I'm not going to worship you. I'm not going to give you my energy. I'm not going to give you my life. I'm not going to participate in this loss scenario, okay, to try and booster this power of loss so we can threaten God and force God to change reality and make us prime creator. Yeah, so those, there were some who came into the world who insisted that it was a fait accompli and that we should worship them. You know, they're kind of like those who have trying to game the system to the ultimate, you know, like the ones that we have, the great hope that we have that somehow we can build up this power, confidence, build this confidence. So you do get in this world those who are super confident. And it, boy, you know, for those who are saying, wait a minute, I'm not sure which is true. I have to determine which is true. You get those who come in the world like super confident, you know, and and yet they're super confident that reality can be changed, and that sets us back. It sets us back, you know. I got set back because of that, honestly. Fortunately, I had the help. We had the help of certain teachings, which came from heart, really came from love, really came from truth, and laid it out and said, look, here's what you need to look at. Which is true? Both can't be true, right? So, because there was genuine teaching in this world from, one is A Course in Miracles, I'm convinced that this came from a genuine truth, from truth. And it presented itself in a way that was, you know, just said, hey, just realize both can't be true. That's all you really need. And then go from there. And it presented itself in a way saying, look, this teaching isn't really necessary. Once you just see that both can't be true, you have within you what it takes. And ultimately, you need to transcend this teaching and set it down. Forget about the words. You know, it did it in a way that was not saying worship me, start a religion, do anything at all. You know, it's the right way. So there's that. And then there's the teachers like Ramana Maharshi and Anandamaya Ma, those who simply radiate assurance that reality can't be changed. And they weren't bothered at all by, they didn't say worship me, I am right, or anything. They didn't care one at all. They simply radiated it quietly, peacefully, loving everything, not asking that we believe them at all or do anything at all, just to radiate that assurance. And if we ask them, they'd say, well, you know, you need to clarify which is true. You know, what is true? Can reality be changed or not? You do have to work on that, and that's all you need to do. The way that they presented it got through to heart, you know. I took it to heart. Because it came from heart. It came from reality. It came from truth. It came from unconditional love. And so that can be taken to heart. And by doing that, I was able to escape the clutches of these, what I call these Shakti gurus, these fake gurus, who assume that it's a fait accompli that we're going to be able to force God to change reality. And they came in this world very powerfully to entrap us into sacrifice, so we all go through this loss that can build up the power of loss. They're like the leaders of this, you know, The leaders. The leaders came to this planet. The leaders of this plan. And you know, wow, you know, intense, unbelievable. The confidence, you know, that they projected into this world was like shocking, or Shakti. You gotta understand, there's Shakti and there's Parashakti. Like Ananda Maima was Parashakti. In other words, the Shakti that frees you from Shakti. The energy that frees you from energy. That kind of thing, you know. The presence that frees you from energy. Energy, the whole realm of energy is this dream of loss. Okay. But what happened in this world is you get those who are the leaders of this plan of energy, and they have all this tremendous energy and confidence that if they just get more energy, they're going to be able to threaten God and force God into changing reality. And so they have this enormous energy, this Shakti field, they call it, of energy around them. They're just, waves of energy are coming off of them. Okay. Waves of energy. If you're aware of them, you see, you can feel all these waves of energy coming off of them. And they have this enormous energetic power and confidence, you know, and they can move energy fields and do all these energetic miracles and stuff. And you're just like, whoa, you know, who is this? And they say, I am God. I am the creator of the universe. I am, you know, and you say, oh my gosh, God is here, you know, and it's like kaboom, you know, and we had that in this world already. And it knocked us for a loop, which is why we are in the situation we're in now, where we're going down this runway and the runway's about to end and we're still not airborne. Yeah. So again, I'm not sure if I should take this on directly or if I should just keep this, you know, in generalities. I don't know. Right now, generalities may be the way to do it. We don't need to name names. We don't need to... those who have been through that will pick up what I'm saying. But it did happen. It did happen that the field of energy that is that we have built up, okay, for so long, that personified itself in this world and said, I am here, you know, this is what truth, this is every, you know, and you need to worship this field of energy and give your energy to it, etc., etc., etc. And it was very, very delay-oriented, okay? Because we don't need to be doing that. We need to be discerning which belief system is true. We need to be in a situation saying, wait a minute, I'm not going to go with this because I'm not sure this is right, which is what I did. I said, wait a minute. Maybe I'll, you know, talk about what happened with me and my whole process. I don't know. But... I said, and I was helped because I was, the grace of God showed me this, no, this one is the Antichrist. This one, you know, this one is the bad news. Stay away. Even though it seemed like this was the prime creator or the heir apparent to prime creator. That's really what it was. The heir apparent to the prime creator came into this world and said, here I am, you know, get with me. Get with me or get nowhere. Yes, that's literally it. We're put under that pressure. You get with me, are you going to be nowhere? You're going to be in Nowheresville because I'm the heir apparent. I'm going to be the new prime creator as soon as this destructive scenario goes through. As soon as you give me all your energy, as soon as you give me everything, then I will be the new prime creator, and you know I will look favorably upon you. We were put under the screws like that. The heir apparent showed up here. And I said, well, I don't know. I need to sort this out. Before I jump into the pool, I need to sort it out. And the heir apparent said, no. You are rejecting me. I said, I'm not rejecting you. I'm merely determining if what you're saying is true or not. And they say, well, you see, you're doubting, and you're that I'm rejecting you because you should be able, if you have any understanding at all, you would clearly see that I'm the heir apparent. And I said, well, I do have a lot of understanding, and it's not clear to me that you're the heir apparent. And then the pressure on me was, well, you it's either what I got was, you know, the heir apparent said either the heir apparent is telling the truth or you're telling the truth. One of us is lying. So who can it be? Look at all this energy power I have, and look at you. You're this sick little nobody, you know, and you're saying that, you know, you're true and I'm telling a lie. Whew, that is the pressure I was under, and the whole world was under that pressure. And I said, well, no, what I'm saying is it's not entirely clear who's telling the truth. You know, who's telling the truth. What I did was I said, well, look, what you're saying is one thing, and what my teachers are saying is another. So one of you is probably lying. And because I had access to, like, Ramana Maharshi and Ananda Maima and Jesus Christ, I said, well, you know, I don't think what you're saying is, I'm not sure if what you're saying is true, aligns with what they said. I'm not sure about that, you know, not sure about that. So we're at a point now where we can get past all this, where we literally don't even need the cornerstones anymore if we can get airborne from this and reject, because by doing so, we're literally rejecting the heir apparent to the Prime Creator, who's already been here. He passed on. He's already passed on, died. But by being airborne, we're rejecting the heir apparent, saying no. There is no heir apparent to Prime Creator. So, you know. And that's why I say, the job is done. Once you get airborne, the job that Jesus has done, the job that Ananda Maima has done, the job that Ramana Maharshi has done, and others, it's done. It's done. It's done. Because their whole thing is to get us airborne at this time. That's their purpose. Because once we get airborne and we say no, once we reject this whole sacrificial scenario that is so important to the belief system that reality can't be changed, it is so important. It was so important that the heir apparent came down into this world. That's how important it is. Once we get airborne, we're rejecting that. And at that point, oh my gosh, you know, we realize, hey, we have the power to say no to the heir apparent, to the Prime Creator. And what else then can really hold us, you know? We realize, even in this most intense pressure, we had the capability to say, uh-uh, I'm not saying you're wrong, but I'm not saying you're right. And the heir apparent demanded that we said that the heir apparent is right, that sacrifice is right, that building up this power of loss is right, that the Prime Creator, the reality can be changed is right, and that we can force the Prime Creator to change it, and that is right. It insisted that we say it's right. And by saying no, I'm not going to say it's right, I'm not going to say it's wrong, but I'm not going to say it's right, I have the power within me to discern whether it's right, and I'm going to spend the time doing that. You have freed yourself. You are freed yourself profoundly, because all the pressure was put on us here. All the pressure was put on us. You see? I don't know what my future videos will be like. I don't know. Maybe I'll get into it with that teacher or not. I don't know. If it's necessary. Maybe it'll set things back. I don't know. We'll see what kind of feedback I get and whatever. But all the pressure was put on us here. All the pressure. I'm telling that for certain, that we were put under the gun here. All the pressure. And the pressure, the political pressure we feel under, that's small potatoes. Okay. That's why I don't get into it. Okay. I know people talk about, you know, there's all this, these laws and these politicians and these bureaucracies, everything, you know, we're being pretty, yeah. But that is true. That is true. All of that is true. But it's small potatoes. Very small potatoes. Very little pressure there. I'm telling you, we were put under the gun here. Big time pressure. Total, ultimate pressure. Literally, the heir apparent to the Prime Creator came to this planet and put the pressure on, saying, you need to submit to me now, or else your opportunity will be lost. And that put the whole planet is under this deep, deep pressure to go ahead with this loss-based scenario. All right? It's at that level. The highest level of pressure was put on us. So, of course, we don't not realize that. We think, you know, there's all this political pressure and laws and all this stuff. We're under that pressure. That's the problem. It's not. We could easily dismiss that. Say, forget it. You know, who are you? You know, what is the Supreme Court? What is the POTUS? What are those to us? Nothing. They have no authority over us. None. I'm not going to base my destiny on based on what these judges and politicians and bureaucrats think, say. Nah, easy to dismiss that. We can all do that in a piece of cake, but we don't realize that because we were put under this intense pressure from the so-called heir apparent, the Shakti guru, you know, the one who seems as though they have the power to, you know, to force God to change reality, because they can change the weather here, they can heal people here, they can do all these miracles here, and we can change the energy patterns here, they can do all this wizardry. You know, we think, oh my gosh, and we're so impressed by that, you know, oh wow, they can do that, they can even change reality, you know, and they can bring this threat to bear upon God and say, God, if you don't change reality for me, I'm going to do it for you, you know. Of course, we know that's a trick, because we can't change reality, but we're trying to trick God into changing it. So this Shakti Guru, this heir apparent, this heir apparent, which is this energy, this subtle, powerful energy that can change other energies. You know, the highest, subtlest level of energy came down to this planet and said, look, I can change all these energy patterns, so I must be able to change reality, or at least saying, look, this is good enough to threaten the Prime Creator, to scare the Prime Creator, and force out of this threat, to force the Prime Creator to change reality for us. And that was brought to bear upon this planet, and all of us here, all of us are under that gun. Okay, so I've been working through this constantly under this horrible pressure, you know, to dismiss this, you know, dismiss it, and to share with you, nah, it's total bluff. I can stand up to it. I've seen it's a total bluff, right? This whole Shakti thing is a total bluff, you know. This subtle energy just put on forms, personality forms, you know, emotional, mental, causal, mental, emotional, etheric, physical form, so it could appear in this world as a form and inform us that it is, in, you know, it is the heir apparent, and we need to align with that, with the Shakti, with the energy. I can tell you for sure, no, we don't. We can align with the inner voice of reason and the clarity within us to determine which of these belief systems is true. We can align with that, which I have done. And by aligning with that, I've been able to overcome the intimidation of the Shakti, okay? The intimidation of the energy. And you can overcome that too. And all you have to do is say, not now, no. You know, say, uh-uh. I'm not ready to go all in to anything right now, including loss. I'm not going to go all in at all. In fact, I don't want to go into it hardly at all. Yeah. See, no loss of life, you know, no loss of feeling of safety, no loss of comfort, no loss of ability to function, no loss of any of that. I'm not willing, no loss of a causal, mental, emotional, etheric, you know, body, no loss of any of that. I'm not willing to do any of that. I don't want to. So You can do that. Now, will enough of us do that at this time to stop the whole thing, which some are trying to do? you know, well, I haven't seen that. It's feasible. It is feasible. But there, also, you have to remember that there's so many here in this world specifically for the purpose to experience this loss. And the overwhelming number of people are here for that. And so if we stopped it for them, they would view us with the utmost hatred and fear. So you know, you got to understand. I know there are a lot of groups around the world who are trying to prevent all this loss scenario from happening. But you have to realize that will absolutely enrage those who are here specifically to experience this. And they would view and whoever stopped it as the absolute, you know, worst devil imaginable, just the Antichrist. They'd look at it that way. And they would attack with utmost ferocity any such efforts to stop it because they believe their salvation is dependent on developing this power of loss, this loss, to threaten the prime creator with it. They believe their salvation. So you'd literally be robbing of them their salvation. So that is not the way, in my opinion. My way is to engage the Passover principle. And for those who want to experience the loss, fine. I don't feel threatened by that. See? Let them experience whatever loss they want to experience. Because they'll never be able to build up any power at all to threaten reality. So reality's not threatened by it. So, and I don't want to make them, drive them into greater fear, you know? So love just says, sure, if that's what you want to do, go ahead. You know, you don't need to, but I'm not going to put obstacles in your path. You got a right to pursue this if you want to. You're free. You're free. You're sovereign. You're free. So I'm going to love the sovereignty and the freedom of you, of everyone, and saying, of course. And I know eventually, you know, they will come around from it. But no, don't try to block it. Don't try to block it. But let it pass you over. Let it pass you over. You have the right to let it pass you over, for sure. You have that right. You don't have to continue along a futile path. No way. Because you're free also. You're and with your freedom, you can exercise to the Passover principle and say, I'm going to let all this pass me by. I'm not going to engage in it. Oh, this stuff in play right now to get that plane off the ground, to get that Passover plane off the ground. And of course, the Shakti is telling us, no, if you leave me now, if you leave me now, you know that song. If you leave me now, you're going to miss out on the new reality, and you're going to end up being annihilated along with everything else that didn't submit to the authority of the Shakti, you know, the energy, the subtle energy. Those who did not submit, those who did not show their loyalty by remaining here, they're going to be, that the new reality is going to pass them by, pass them over entirely. You know, that's the bluff. Not true. There is no new reality. There is no new prime creator. Never will be. You will not be passed over. The only thing that will pass you over is loss. This whole scenario of loss will pass you over. But that will leave you with what? Reality. Perfection. Invulnerability. Everything that you really want. That's what you'll be left with. So it's a bluff. Shakti is bluffing. Energy is bluffing. And this energy came into this world, personified itself in this world, and put on a major bluff, you know? Major bluff. And thank God for those who knew this was coming and provided us the antidote ahead of time. We wonder why such a personification of divinity came in the world in personification of total assurance that reality is not threatened by anything at all. Total assurance. Reality is not threatened by loss. Loss does not threaten reality one bit. That total assurance personified itself in the world in Ananda Mayama, personified itself here. And just basically just, you know, sat, you know, just, that's all it did was just radiate that assurance. Talk, you know, talk and give out some advice. If someone asked advice, spiritual advice, some advice would be given out. While giving, all the while, just this total radiant assurance, you know, radiant assurance that all is well in reality. Reality is not threatened by any dreams of its destruction, that mind cannot create any power to change reality, that all this is simply nonsense, and all this loss does not cause the slightest concern for reality whatsoever. That was radiated into this planet. Ramana Maharshi radiated also. Those two great radiators of assurance. And then Jesus Christ brought conceptually, radiated at the level of conceptuality, and of Course in Miracles radiated that assurance also. And the combination of those was the antidote to the Shakti that personified itself in this world and insisted that we accept what they're saying, that they're the heir apparent to Prime Creator, and therefore we, to be smart, spiritually smart, to submit to this new Prime Creator. See, the radiation of the assurance of Ramana, Ananda, my Ma, Jesus Christ, and others was the antidote to this. And that enabled me to see through it, to get past it. Without it, I would not have got past it. Believe me, this is true. Without the help of God's grace in the form of Ramana, Ananda, my Ma, and A Course in Miracles, it's from Jesus Christ, I would not be here. Guaranteed, I would not have made it. I would not have made it. It was too intense. The bluff. It was like the ultimate bluff. And you know, none of us were at that point in time if not for the radiance of this assurance that reality is not threatened by loss, cannot be changed, we wouldn't have had sufficient grounding, I don't think, I know we wouldn't have had. What would have happened is that we would have delayed more, and we would get caught up in this whole loss scenario. We would have delayed, for sure. We would have delayed. But instead, I was able to face this down and say, Shakti, you're not forcing me to bow to you. Because I know there are teachers greater than you, and they're not asking me to bow to them. So why in the world should I bow to you? You know? Ananda Maima never asked me to bow to her. Neither did Ramana. And neither did Jesus Christ. No, they just said, hey, salvation comes from within you. You can see it. Clarify it for yourself. You can do it. And believe me, reality is not threatened by any dreams of loss. It's not threatened by loss at all. So take that on faith. Take it to heart what I'm showing you. And then work to clarify this. You can do it. You can do it. You can do it. That's what they gave me. They didn't say, submit to me. Give your energy to me. I am the authority, you must submit to me. They didn't claim anything like that. They said, hey, check it out. You know, really? Yes, freedom was there. Freedom was there, the feeling of freedom. So I was able to look at the Shakti, personification of Shakti, and say, wait a minute. You know, you're not better than Ananda Maima. In fact, you're not even as good as Ananda Maima, and yet you're asking me to submit to you because you're the heir apparent to the Prime Creator, whereas Ananda Maima saying, no, there is no heir apparent to the Prime Creator. There is, reality can't be changed. I said, so now something isn't right here. You know, either Ananda Maima's lying or you're lying. So I had the allies. Either Ramana is lying or you're lying. Either Jesus Christ is lying or you're lying. One of the two. So something doesn't add up here. I said, something doesn't add up here. So I'm going to figure out what's amiss. Something's amiss. Something's amiss here. You know, so. And then they put the pressure on me saying, well, you're showing a lack of faith, and then this is going to be to your detriment. You're going to be left behind. I'm going to pass you over. That's what the pressure was. If you don't submit now, I'm going to pass you over, and you're not going to be part of the new kingdom. That was the bluff, and that was terrifying, and caused utmost suffering in me and fear. Terrible fear. is Hardball. This planet has been under Hardball. And the fact is that Romana, Anandamayama, and A Course in Miracles came about at the right time so that prior to the Shakti personifying here in the world, knowing that it would happen, so that we would have this remedy already, this deep conviction already here. And what happens, of course, in miracles enabled us to work on it at a conceptual level that also helped block the whole Shakti thing, which was trying to assert its intellectual superiority or its conceptual superiority over us. And I said, wait a minute. You know, you sound so superior, but A Course in Miracles sounds even better. So you're not necessarily, maybe you're the heir apparent, but I'm not positive that there is going to be an heir apparent, right? So I cannot buy into this heir apparent thing. I say, you're not Prime Creator now. And therefore, you say, well, yeah, but I'm going to be heir apparent. And I say, yeah, but I'm not sure there's going to be an heir apparent. Because Anandamayama says no. Jesus Christ says no. Ramana says no. There is no heir apparent to reality. So one of you is not, you know, something doesn't add up here. Something doesn't add up. And, of course, then the bluff kept coming that, you know, I'm going to pass you by. Hey, you know, you're not capable of getting it. You know, you're somehow flawed. That's why I'm flawed. You know, the pressure was on me that I'm flawed. Somehow I can't get it, and I'm not in alignment with the new reality, and so I'm going to be what left behind. You know, it was that kind of terror tactics, really. It's really terror tactics, spiritual terrorist, really. And I was terrified, absolutely terrified, because I said, hey, honestly, I'm not ready to buy into it yet. And then the pressure was, well, you're going to be left behind then. I said, well, you know, wow, that's pretty scary. Pretty scary. And, of course, the Shakti always says, oh, yeah, Ramana and Anandamayamanji, they all work underneath. They all work for me. They're under me. They're my helpers. I said, really? 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 I said, oh, yeah. They're just the reason why they seem to not jive with me because I'm superior to them and they don't quite understand the whole picture. Yeah, that was all said here. And so that filtered down through the intelligentsia, through this world, filtered down. And we all kind of got cowed. We got cowed, you know, which is why maybe I'm going to be pushing back. I don't know. I'm pushing back right now very strongly. I don't know to how specific I'm going to get. We were all cowed, you know, but not entirely, you know. We bent, but we didn't break. I bent, but I didn't break. But boy, did I bend, literally. I mean, just to the point of almost snapping, no question about it. We have to be forgiving ourselves because, you know, this pressure was so intense that many of us may have almost snapped and gone through a lot of stuff like we wouldn't have gone through otherwise. Really, with the whole energy thing, you know, instead of just easily cruising through this. I mean, you know, we think, wow, I should just have been able to cruise through this. How come I'm still uncertain? Because we were put under this total ultimate pressure just to submit to falsity, really, to this notion that it's a fait accompli, which it is not, to this notion that reality can be changed, which is not true. We were put under the ultimate pressure. So of course we went a little haywire here and there, you know, under this, like, a, you know, the most ferocious hurricane imaginable, you know, stuff's flying and you know we're like, you know, in our storm cellar as the roof is being blown off the house. So of course we suffered, you know, and we clung to straws, you know. We tried to say, wow, maybe I better go along with this to a certain extent, with this whole Shakti Guru thing and this whole thing. Maybe I better go along with it to a certain extent. I don't want to be completely left behind, as the threat was, that we would be literally excluded from the new kingdom. That was a threat, no question about it. Now, the truth is there isn't going to be any new kingdom. That is the truth. Reality remains pristine, immaculate, inviolate. It will always be that way. We just simply return to reality. We don't enter into any new kingdom. Shakti energy is not going to create a new kingdom. Shakti is just going to continue this whole charade of lust, continually trying to generate some power that it can then threaten God and force God's hand to change reality, and that'll never happen. So energy just continues on in its impotent path, really. It's impotent. Existence is impotent. Can never develop power. Yeah, totally impotent, but very full of braggadocio, you know, and fluff. So we need to take some deep breaths and respect ourselves. Why say we made it this far? That's an incredible accomplishment. Incredible. And today happens to be my birthday, you know, and I made it this far. That's it's fabulous. Incredible. Thank God, you know, and thanks to those who have helped us, because making it this far is simply meaning that we've bent, but we haven't broken under all that pressure. You know, we didn't break, we didn't snap. We're still cowed. We're still cowed. You know, I'm still cowed. You know, maybe operating at like 10% or something of assurance. You know, or whatever, very small. But we're starting to unfreeze. We got to do it fast. You know, got to do it fast. And I may be pouring out videos to help you with this. If you know, it's possible. I have a way where I can probably do this. I don't want to violate copyright laws. That is the problem. I'm not sure. You know, these teachers, they're so sticklers on copyright, aren't they? They don't want a single picture of them, a video, anything about them to be in the public domain or Creative Commons. So they don't want any commentary on themselves. They don't want their picture to be put up there and say, look, and I talk about them. No, they'll say, I'll sue you for copyright infringement. If you know, that you can tell. You can tell who's who by that right there, you know, right there. And Anna my ma, she never put any restrictions on any of her pictures or whatever. Never. Never. And basically the Sangha doesn't need it, really. And those who took pictures of her usually make them freely available, you know. She never brought up any issue about copyright or anything. But no. Ramana, same thing. The real teachers don't worry about copyright, saying, forget it. No. Feel free. If you want to use my image, feel free. Absolutely. And yet you look at these other teachers, my God, they say basically, we're going to, you know, crucify you if you use anything whatsoever. My picture, my talk, my images, any videos, anything in the book, anything, we're going to crucify you if you do that. You know, pretty obvious, isn't it? Because they don't want to be held up to clarification. They don't want us to take a close look. You know, they don't want me to talk about them, you know. So, you know, some of these teachers, literally, I can't get a single picture, it seems like, that's in Creative Commons. Or if I do use their picture, I'm pretty sure they would, you know, throw a lawsuit at me, you know, which I'm not interested in, because they would contest it. It might be in the public domain, but they would contest it and say, that's our intellectual property. You cannot show that, because what else do they have? You know, when you hold them up to examination, you realize they're bluffing. So all that they have is legal intimidation, really. You know, and they do legally intimidate to an extreme extent. So I'm searching, try to find a way to help, you know, without getting entangled, you know, without getting targeted, you know, with lawsuits. Yeah, I'm not sure if at this time maybe it's too late. Maybe we just go for it because we've got such a short time. To hell with it, you know. Just sorry, to heck with it. Got to keep things very civil. And just use their images, use everything. Forget about the copyright thing. You know, I don't know. That's the question. I need to resolve that. In the meantime, I'll try to do the best that I can. Because we have to call their bluff. And we have to say no, you know, in a loving way. We're just saying not now, not now. I'm not sure. I'm not sure if you're heir apparent. I'm not sure if there's going to be a new prime creator. And I'm not willing to jump in to your boat at this point, you know? Not yet. Not now. You know, we don't have to condemn them. You know, I know they're wrong. I know they're lying. I know they're deceiving. But we don't have to go to that extent simply to say, hey, you know, I have the right to sort this out. And this, what you're saying is you must go with me now or be passed over. You know what? That's going too far. I'm not going to let you put that over on me. You can even say, hey, Clarity Ross says, yeah, you know, no, no. And Clarity Ross is saying, because Ananda Mayama said, hey, back off. You know, don't have to, that reality is not threatened. There is not going to be any new reality. So this whole idea that I'm going to be passed over, reality is going to pass, the new reality is going to pass me over, no. I'm going to examine that. I'm going to examine that because I got the, at least the some authority here that, yeah, that's the right thing to do. It's the right thing to do. What I'm saying, you have the authority within you to say no to this bluff, this pressure. Because, you know, Ramana wasn't pressured, Ananda Ma wasn't pressured, Jesus Christ is not pressured. They're not going along with this bluff. Not at all. They're saying reality is perfect. It always will be perfect. It's not threatened by anything. Truth is not threatened by anything. Just abide in it. Trust it. I assure you this is so. They gave us this assurance. So here comes somebody saying, oh, I'm the heir apparent. There's going to be a new reality. I'm going to be a new prime creator. You got to, you know, you're going to be passed over, blah, blah, blah. You know, at the very least, we can say, whoa, wait a minute. I think you might be mistaken, and I want to take the time to determine if this is so or not. So I'm not getting in your boat, no. At least do that. At least do that. I've done that. Definitely have done it. I've done the, you know, the minimum that is required. At least I've done the minimum. Say, no, wait a minute, no. And then from there, done more and more and more to the point where I can now speak out about this. But you don't have to speak out about it if you don't want to. You know, most people, the reason why no one's, very few are speaking out on this, they fear retribution, you know. They really do. People have left these cults, you know, and they've been terrified to speak out. And they've banded together in groups and gradually trying to speak out a little bit. But they're frightened, you know. It's very frightening. People are, you know, after all, do you really want to anger the heir apparent to the prime creator? Do you really want to get on their bad side? We want to play it safe, right? We want to play it safe. So you don't have to necessarily speak up, but if you want to, you can, maybe. But you can internally make a decision. Like, wow, you say, I want to sort this out. Okay, I don't want to get a whole bunch more evidence for loss. I don't want to go, I want to sort it out. Oh, that's what I want to do. I know that someone's lying here. Someone's lying. Okay, you can say, you know, either, and therefore, I want to sort it out. Okay, insist on that. Insist on that. And for most, that's the highest they can reach for right now. For most, that's the highest. But insist on that. I realize that a lot of my teaching is over the heads of everyone here because it's based on, you know, moving past all of this bluff and finally getting past it and seeing, ah, you know, okay, made it. And then progress is very rapid then. But like I said, the loss-free realm is for me, I can go there. But for most, that is in not yet to be determined. So the teaching's kind of over, you know, beyond what most are willing to do right now because they're still a little bit worried. They don't want to get on the bad side of this supposed heir apparent to the prime creator. So the most that most can do, the most that most can do is to say, wait a minute, I got to sort this out, and I got the right to do it. to take that courageous step, because that's a real, that does call the bluff of this heir apparent to the prime creator, so to speak. Because they're saying, no, you got to do it now. You got to jump all in now. You got to go through this loss scenario. You got to trust in that, you know. They insist on your trust. They insist on it. And if you say, wait a minute, I got to sort it out, they insist that you're not trusting them, right? See, so it is a huge step that I'm saying you need to take, and you can take. It's just saying, wait a minute, I don't know who to trust. I need to sort it out. I need to sort it out. But you say I kind of trust in the ones who are saying I need to sort it out. I kind of trust that. I feel that's the right way to go, even though I'm not sure, but I'm putting a little bit more weight there, because I know someone's lying, and I have a right to sort that out. I have that right. That's all I'm saying. You have the right to sort it out. Trust in that. Trust in that. Trust in that. Trust in that you have the right to sort it out. Okay? You don't have to trust in what I'm saying about, you know, I know for sure which is true. But just take the step. I trust in your intuition. You have the right to sort it out. Because both can't be true, right? Either reality can be changed or it can't be changed. You have the right to sort that out. That is all I'm saying. Assert that right. Assert that right. Assert it within you. You don't need to necessarily say anything. If something needs to be said, I'll say it. Or if you want to say something, that's fine too. But for a long time, I didn't say anything. I was too scared, too intimidated. And gradually, I've been saying more and more and more and more and more and more. But holy cow, were we under the pressure here? Were we intimidated here? Wow. Okay, assert your right to sort it out. And then whatever is not working on sorting it out is going to pass you by. It is going to pass you by. And you will find yourself in a situation where you're able to sort it out. You'll find yourself in that situation. I am saying that it may be somewhat of an amazing ride in the coming up, because the situation, putting yourself in a situation to sort it out, you may find that the Passover is more than you expect. Because literally, this world has been turned into a situation where no one has the right to sort it out. That is essentially what's happening. It came from the very highest, subtlest energies down on this planet, all the way down. The whole world is being configured into a situation which says basically to you, you don't have the right to sort it out. You have to decide one way or the other now permanently. And you got no other opportunity. That's a lie. That's a bold-faced lie. You always have the opportunity to sort it out. The prime creator is not threatened by dreams of this destruction. It's not threatened at all. It gives you unlimited time to sort it out. The prime creator, all the prime creator is asking of you, sort it out. Find out who's telling the truth. Find out what is a lie and find out what is true. Either reality can be changed or it can't be changed. Find out. That's the prime creator just says, you got all the time in the world. You can use however much time you want, but you have that right to sort it out. So there is no such thing as either you make it now, you never make it. Either you got the right to say, no, I want to take some more time to sort it out. But on this planet now, the whole thing is being configured down to trying to say you have to decide now or you get no more chance. That's it. That's a lie. Putting you under that pressure. And so, of course, you're going, and under those circumstances, you're going to jump into what you're familiar with. You're going to stick with what's familiar. And what's familiar is the loss, continuing with this belief system of loss. That is what you're familiar with. And so you're going to go along with that. So what I'm saying is all you need is assert the right to sort it out. Yeah. Assert that right. You don't have to say which one is which yet. It's all important you assert the right to sort it out right now. And reject the notion that it's now or never. Reject that notion. Okay. That you somehow have to make that deep internal decision of which is true and which is a lie, which is true, that you have to come to an ultimate conclusion right now. If you have to come to an ultimate conclusion right now, you're going to side on the side of what you're familiar with, which is the belief system that reality can be changed. That's what you're familiar with. You will side with that if you think you have to come to a definitive conclusion right now. So this whole world is being configured to the point where no more sorting out, no more time spent in sorting out. That is the pressure we're under. And I reject that entirely. And you can too. You have the right to sort it out. Prime Creator supports that right. Guaranteed, Prime Creator supports that right. Therefore, if you assert this right, you will be passed by this whole draconian effort by the Shakti, the energy, to force you in thinking you have to make a final decision now, which would inevitably cause you to decide with the energy, with this Shakti, with the heir apparent, with this lost scenario. You would inherently do that because that's what you're super familiar with. Only a few who have used their time extremely wisely would choose otherwise, say, no way, no way. And I can't even guarantee for myself that I would reject that and choose choose that reality cannot be changed. I can't even be certain of that. But I know that we don't need to be 100% certain of it. We only need to assert our right to sort it out, okay? And then this whole situation of denying you that right to sort it out will have to pass you by. It'll basically say you're a reject. You are going to be not included in the new kingdom. You're a reject. Yeah, that's the bluff. It's a bluff. And so we have to stand up to this bluff, which is why I'm here. The whole purpose of my coming here is standing up to this bluff, being one who is standing up to this bluff and asserting my right. And in doing so, you can realize, hey, I can assert my right too. I'm not alone. I'm not alone in asserting my right, you see? Very important. It's super important that you assert your right, that you have time to figure it out, to discern which is true. Either reality can be changed or it can't be changed. Which one of those is true? You have the right to sort that out. And no one has the right the effort to assert otherwise is not held up by reality. It's not true. You can at least go that far. How can it be true that you don't have a right, not even give you the right to see clearly which is true? You're supposed to go on blind faith. Prime Creator is not asking you to go on blind faith. Prime Creator is asking you to sort it out. That's why you have the voice of reason within you. Prime Creator says sort it out, because it's not threatened by lies. It says sort it out. Take the time. Sort it out. Whereas the other is saying, no, don't take any time. You have to jump, decide. Without any sorting out whatsoever, you should be able to just, you know, be loyalty. What are you loyal to? You know, prove your loyalty. That kind of thing. Right now. No more time. No. Because obviously, it feels threatened by you taking time to sort it out. Because it knows if you take the time to sort it out, you'll see that it's lying. That is why. But this whole world, the opportunity in this world to really spend the time to sort it out, that is vanishing. It is vanishing. Thank God I took the opportunity when it was possible. You know, I was under the pressure. Jesus, my teachers pressured me saying, go. You know, I'd ask them questions. They say, hey, go, faster. I say, yeah, but what about this? And they didn't even answer the questions. They just said, get going. Go faster. Come on. Use your time wisely. Because soon in this world, it will be, you know, extremely difficult to use your time this way. Because obviously, you won't be a loyalist, will you? You'll say, I don't know what is true and what is a lie, but I don't know. So I'm not loyal to either right now. That's a problem coming up. You are expected to be a loyalist coming up. guaranteed. All right, you are supposed to radiate an assurance that you've gone all in. And literally all this stuff, this technology, everything is being used to collect data to be able to eventually determine who has gone all in and who hasn't. And those who have not gone all in, they're going to be put under the screws. All right? They won't have any chance to sort it out. It's going to be brutalized. That's what all this whole system, that this new world order that's coming into this world, is coming down from the subtler levels. It's being designed to assess and identify everyone on the planet who has gone all in, who is loyal and who is not. And those who are not, again, they're going to be put to the screws very severely. Re-educated, as it were. Okay. So that's why I say it's a crisis. So I'm not saying you have to determine once and for all who's telling that what's a lie and what's true. I'm saying you have to assert your right for your destiny to be aligned with using your time to determine what's a lie and what is true. Can reality be changed or can reality not be changed? Which of those is true and which is a lie? Your destiny, you align your destiny with your right to spend your time sorting that out. You don't need to spend your time in some re-education camp of the New World Order, brutalizing you into being loyal to, its point of view. Loyal to the heir apparent, right? That is what is happening here. Loyal to the heir apparent. You wonder why we bow and fawn to these political leaders, and you look at them and say, oh my gosh, they got feet of clay big time. Why am I worshiping them, And the truth is because we think they're the heir apparent. We're worshiping the heir apparent principle. The heir apparent principle is what we're worshiping. We're thinking, sure, they got feet of clay, but once they become prime creator, that'll be gone. So either you believe there's an heir apparent will become prime creator, or you say, no, that will never happen. You're in two different camps. And this world wants everyone to be in the camp of believing in the heir apparent and to be loyal to that. And they're going to, technical capability to read your thoughts, your emotions, everything now. It's very sophisticated. It'll become more and more, and literally everyone will be assessed and be determined where you stand. Are you loyal to the heir apparent? Or do you have doubts? If you have doubts, re-education time. And of course, since everybody has doubts, everybody's going to eventually be, put under this process. And the process is actually gets more and more intense. And all this loss occurs, and you're supposed to go along with that to prove your loyalty. See, this whole scenario is set up to design you to prove your loyalty to the heir apparent through embracing loss and death and suffering, etc. So this whole scenario is like a loyalty test. What's happening in the future is like a hazing, to get into a sorority or fraternity. It's like a hazing ritual. That's what it really is. Okay, this is a better way to look at it. It's a hazing ritual. A severe hazing ritual to determine, do you have the right stuff to get into this fraternity sorority? All right? Do you have the right stuff? Are you really loyal to the heir apparent? And here's the opportunity to prove it. So 7 billion people are here on this planet, super eager to say, yeah, I can prove my loyalty to the heir apparent. And here's the opportunity. So of course they don't want that opportunity snatched away from. Don't try to get in their way. They're going to go through this hazing ritual. But you just say, forget it. I'm not going to go through any hazing ritual. I didn't go through any fraternity thing or anything like that because I said, no way, I'm not going to go through any hazing whatsoever. I rejected the whole notion of hazing and all that stuff. You got to prove yourself. I don't have to prove myself to anybody. I just nearly need to determine, can a reality be changed or can it not be changed? Which is true? Which is true? Either reality can be changed or it can't be changed. Which is true? And if one is true, the other has to be a lie. That's all I need to determine. I don't need any hazing. So you don't have to go through this hazing ritual that's coming up. It's a severe one, because it's designed to once and for all determine who is loyal and who is not. And those who are loyal are supposedly going to then accompany the heir apparent into the new kingdom, and those who are not loyal are supposed to be cast into an abyss and burned forever to eternal hell and annihilate their souls annihilated or something like that, you know. So it takes a lot of clarity and courage to stand up this and say, wait a minute, no, I'm not ready yet. I'm not ready. I want to spend my time determining, making this determination, this all-important determination. You assert that, and you've stood up to the bluff. You've stood up to it. And once you realize you've stood up to it, wow, then you really can, clarity just, poof, the whole thing. You know, it's like, wow, I think I get it. You know, you really see it. You start seeing it. You see the whole picture. Then you say, oh, I get it. I said, do I really get it? Do I really have it? And then you kind of, do I really have it? But yeah, I said, yeah, I do. Really? Yeah. It's that simple. It's that simple. The whole thing is that simple. And so we're at the crucial point right now. The crucial point. Where we have to at least say my destiny. I'm aligning my destiny with the opportunity to sort this out and determine. Either reality can be changed or it can't, which is true and which is false. Aligning my destiny with that, I don't have to make the ultimate determination right now. I don't have to. I don't have to, and I insist that I be given an opportunity to spend my time making this determination. I'm not interested in any re-education camps. I'm not interested in any loyalty tests. I'm not interested in going through any hazing process. No. Not yet. Not yet. And of course, the heir apparent says, this is your last chance. Of course they say that. It's all a bluff. There'll be other chances. Because it doesn't work. I guarantee you, if you want other chances, there'll be other places and chances to go through some hazing process, if that's what you want to do. It's all a bluff. It's all a bluff. 100% a bluff. And you may not be sure of it, but you may have enough intuition saying, you know what, it probably is a bluff. I'm not sure. Probably is. So I want my destiny to be one that gives me time to sort this out. There you go. That's good enough. That's good enough. My only, you know, I just keep doing this. Hopefully more people, I'll get more viewers. There'll be more viewers here. Not for my sake, but for your sakes, you know, to hear this and to realize you can take that one all-important step and say, ah, I'm not ready to decide one way or the other yet. That's it. And to know either reality can be changed or it can't be changed. They both can't be true. And you say, they both can't be true, and I'm not ready to decide which one is true yet, and I insist that my destiny be spent determining which is true. And by knowing which is true, I know the other is a lie. It's false. I insist that my destiny be spent that way, and I'm not ready again to make the ultimate determination on either side. But I insist that my time be spent where I can clearly make a unbiased, clear determination, not based on blind faith, not based on blind loyalty, not based on familiarity, not based on any of that, but only based on clear seeing. And I insist that my destiny be spent that way. And by doing that one step, you will have done everything you need to do right now. You will have made it. That's escape velocity. That's escape velocity. And that's what we're all about here, escape velocity. Whew. This is my birthday present to you, the world, you know. I made it this far, you know, that's something. I was not sure I would, that is for sure. Really, 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 really. But in making it this far, that's a great thing. because we're at the point now where we can let it all out, you know, let the cat out of the bag, which is, you know, a great time. It's a time of pressure because, you know, this hazing process is about ready to kick into high gear. You know, the fraternity brothers and the sorority sisters have got it all set up. Believe me, they got it all set up. And they got all the hazing rituals all set up for us, you know. And everybody's eager. Most people are eager to get it going, you know. Because they want to prove their loyalty. They want it because they want entrance into the new kingdom. That is what's happening here. See it that way and you say, oh my gosh, it's so simple. Yeah. And yet we, you know, there's some of us who don't want to go through those hazing rituals. No, no. We don't have to. Don't have to. Be assured of that. But we still have to take that little step, you know, saying, okay, no, I'm aligning my destiny with making the discernment here. I know I have to make it. That's what I want to do. And I assure you, that's a fabulous destiny. No better way to spend your time. No better way. I mean, I'd rather do this than anything. There's no better way because literally you can smell the freedom. You get the scent of freedom. You're on its track. You're tracking it down like a hound dog. You know, you smell it. You know you're following the trail. And you know you're going to find it. And that's fabulous, tremendous. Because, you know, I've got the capacity to determine what is true and what is false. I have the capacity. I'm just not quite sure which is yet, but I know I got the capacity. I know I have it. So, you know you're going to if you're time that way. So, no need for any loyalty tests. No need for any hazing, right? Keep your future free of that. And then spend your time wisely. All right, well, again, happy to be able to share this with the world on the birthday today. Using the time the right way. And maybe we'll keep pushing. Well, let me give this a rest here and we'll also give you a chance to view it. I know it's like a couple hours here. But it is a couple hours very, very well spent. I hope you can feel that. Because for me, this is like a laser. You know, we're really focusing in now. More and more tightly. The laser beam is focusing in more and more tightly, very focused on what's going on. Yeah, we got this hazing ritual coming up to prove our loyalty to the heir apparent to the prime creator. Okay? Super good way to look at it. Super good way to look at it. Yeah, very helpful. Okay. Very great. That's it for this video.